Hey, brothers and sisters, I love y'all, and we're family, and we're still looking for Jesus. I'm still clinging to the possibility he is coming in August, and I would like for him to come today or tomorrow or the 22nd. I love the number 22, and I always want to think about us leaving on the 22nd. God loves the number 22 also. There are 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. And there are, you know, Genesis 22 is like one of the most fantastic stories in the entire Bible. I remember when I read that and it just all made sense. I just love, and we got Psalm 22, right? Psalm 22 of Jesus, the prophecy of Jesus on the cross. Revelation 22, the end of the book. Galatians 5, 22, fruit of the Spirit. Y'all, you know, he talks to us in different ways. Sometimes he talks to us in dreams and visions, and sometimes it's the still small voice. Like yesterday, he talked to me in the still small voice when I woke up. And also it can be like in a song, or it can be in numbers. And I see numbers all the time. Anyway, I have a hymnal. I have a piano and a hymnal, but I can't say that I play the piano very much. So anyway, I have a hymnal from the church. I guess you could say, I don't know if they gave this to me or whether I stole it. I don't know. Lord help me if I did. I hope I didn't. I think they gave it to us. But I don't know. I think I might have had it from the choir, and then when I left that church, that I still had it. So Lord, forgive me if this was something that I need to repent of, that I actually stole from the church. I hope I didn't. Anyway, I opened it up. I hadn't looked at it in a while. And so for people who don't know about hymns, the reason why I really like hymns and older music is that the lyrics are very biblical. And I had somebody ask me about how do you know if a song is biblical? Well, a lot of the contemporary music is hard. It's kind of hard. First of all, you got to know your Bible, which means read your Bible every day. That's what people are supposed to do. Read your Bible every day. And then when people are writing new songs, they're supposed to write new songs that are based on scripture. But there are a lot of contemporary songs that are all about me, 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 and what God does for me, when we're supposed to, yes, we're grateful for what God does for us, but it's also, you know, praise and worship. And the hymns, you know, like there are hymnal websites that you can go and look at all the hymns and find out the backstories. There have been books written about certain songs, like It Is Well With My Soul has an incredible story behind it. And a blind woman named Fanny Crosby, she wrote so many hymns. But the hymns, it's just a safe bet that if it's a hymn, it's an old song, and the lyrics are based on the Bible. So anyway, I opened up to, this is a few days ago, I opened up to Sweet, Sweet Spirit. And, you know, I'm going to try this, but I have had problems that when I try to include a song, YouTube gives me a copyright violation and they won't let it post. So I'm just going to try this. The reason why I thought it was kind of funny is that I opened up to Sweet, Sweet Spirit a few days ago. And I so long to sing with instruments and to sing with other people. But that's the reason why I sing a cappella without anything in my videos, because of YouTube problems. But I thought it's funny, when I came to this song here, I didn't know this person, Doris Akers, but I paused it at 104. And the funny thing was, you know, I like to talk. Okay. I like to talk. I had a funny thing happen, because I went to give blood plasma on Monday, and I put my Jesus, you know, they require you had a mask on. So I had my Jesus mask on. And it turned out that the woman who was, it's a longer process, but the woman who was taking my plasma, she started telling me about how she suspected that her husband was having at least an emotional affair over, I think it was a Facebook group or something. And so she had to shut that down. And I was trying to, you know, I was trying to witness to her a little bit, but not really. I mean, obviously my Jesus mask is witnessing to her. And that's probably why the reason that she came out and started telling me about the situation in her marriage. Then she had to go on break. And then the person that came to finish me up, her name, oh my goodness, I can't remember her first name, but her last name was De Jesus. Her husband is from Puerto Rico. And I said, oh, are you a believer? And she said, I'm a believer, but my husband, that's his name, is not a believer, even though his name is De Jesus, basically, De Jesus. And so we talked a little bit about the end times, and I ended up giving her my Left Behind. I'd taken a Left Behind letter with me, and always I have my gospel tracts with me. And so I gave her a gospel tract that she could leave for him and a Left Behind letter that she could leave for him. But she's you know, she's not like crazy looking for the rapture like I am. And a lot of us are looking crazy for the rapture. But she knows that the rapture could happen any day. And, you know, she would like for her husband to be saved after the rapture. I did go back to the video that I had done, He Lives. I went back to that video and put in the description box a Left Behind letter. I put it in, but for some reason it had disappeared, so I went and put it back in. And then after that, and I'm going to get back to that video in a minute because I want to tell y'all something. Then after that, I talked with Renee, who was the receptionist, setting up an appointment. And it was kind of funny because she's a believer. She's like me, a single woman, not looking to get, she's older than I am. I'm 60. I think she was like 68, 65, 68 or something like that. Years and years of being single. Years of being misunderstood by her family, and you know, why wouldn't she get remarried? Years and years of talking to seriously, I couldn't believe it. Years and years of talking to pastors who were wolves in sheep's clothing, who were actually coming after her, right? And you know, just being misunderstood. But you know, she clearly had the Holy Spirit. She was like, I was just talking yesterday with a friend about Jesus coming back. It's just so obvious. So we were talking. We were having a really good time. I stayed there probably another hour and a half after I had been finished up. And there was a woman there, real loud, boisterous woman that, you know, you can just tell in the spirit that this is clearly a unbeliever. But she was kind of listening to what we had going on. So then she came by me and she said, I'd like to go to heaven. And I said, oh, okay. So I pulled out my gospel tract, You're Not Alone, and I handed it to her. And she goes, oh, I don't want any of that Bible stuff. And I said, well, you asked how to go to heaven. This isn't a Bible, right? This is just to tell you how to go. And as she was walking back, she's like, okay. And then there was this young black man who said, and the reason why I'm using the color, because Renee said something that I thought was very interesting. So this was a young black man with very dark skin, but he said, many are called, but few are chosen. I was like, oh, here we know a guy who knows his Bible, who is a believer. So it turned out, I continued to talk to Renee. Renee is a lighter skinned black woman. She ended up telling me that there is actually racism. You know, I'm just a white woman who doesn't, I mean, I have some really great friends that are black, but I did not know this. But Renee said that there is actually a lot of racism that she has found, even within her own family, for her being a lighter skinned black instead of a darker skinned black. I don't understand this, but she said, you need to know this, Terry. And I said, well, isn't it great that all of us who are believers, we are all one in the spirit, you know, and one in love and one in baptism. We're the church and we're ready for Jesus to come. And it really does not matter what our skin color is. Anyway, the woman who had taken the gospel tract, she came back after she had finished and she said, you can have this back. There's a cost. That's what she said. There's a cost. And there is a cost to following Jesus. So my appointment to give plasma, again, she made it for September 14th. And I laughed and I said, you know, I'm expecting the rapture any day. I don't think I'm going to be here September 14th, but I will make it. Then I come out and I get in the car and the time is 4:01. And here I noticed that the time that I paused this video is at 1:04. So 14 is the day of Nisan that Jesus died on the cross. So there's a 14. And then I was like, God, why, you know, it's kind of funny. Why 4:01 that I came and got back in the car? And I thought, oh, it's like a reverse of the 14. I'm just always thinking about Jesus. Well, the funniest thing is, you know, Karen in Israel, she's been at college. Her dorm room is room 401. I think that's so funny. My dorm room, as here we are looking at this, 212, that was my dorm room number. It was also the room number of my honeymoon hotel room. So anyway, if anybody is still listening to this old woman run on, well, guess what? I became a grandmother yesterday. And I wanted to tell everybody I've got a new grandson who was actually born on the same day as my son's 28th birthday. And, you know, my kids don't think I should be talking about them on YouTube, so I'll probably get an, if they, I don't think they watch, but if they do, they're probably getting mad right now. But, you know, I'm a mother. I had twin girls, and I have a son. And so he doesn't even want me to say what his name is. He thinks that's a violation of his privacy, so I'm not going to say what his name is. But it was his birthday yesterday, and he was 28 years old. And it turns out that my grandson, who I'm not going to say what his name is, but he was born at 9 p.m. last night on my son's birthday. Oh my goodness, I just noticed this has 33 thumbs up, which means come now, and 3 down. So there's your also your 333. That's kind of funny. I can't help it. I see numbers. I just can't help it. I see numbers. So, you know, I think, and she acknowledged that they had been praying for a safe delivery. Everything went really well. She was induced yesterday, and then the baby was born at 9 o'clock last night, which would have been the time in Texas where she lives. And actually, it's kind of a big deal because this is the first baby in my family. My children are 6th generation Atlantans and 11th generation Georgians. And this was the first baby that was not born in Atlanta, Georgia. So, in a long time. Anyway, back to the song, because the song, I looked at a few videos of it, and they don't sing both verses, so I wanted to sing this song, and we'll see. I don't know if it'll work, that YouTube will, and maybe that I'm just talking and YouTube's going to block this video, but anyway. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know that it's the presence of the Lord. Then I want to see if I can put this in without YouTube blocking it, because I just love this and I just want to sing along. Sweet Holy Spirit.
Sweet Holy Spirit.
Sweet Heavenly Dove.
Sweet Heavenly Dove.
Stay right
stay
here with us.
Right here with us.
Filling us
with your love.
I can't wait for us to be up in heaven and sing the rest of it. But let me sing the second verse, because it's, there are blessings you cannot receive till you know him in his fullness and believe. You're the one to profit when you say, I am going to walk with Jesus all the way. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, you're right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we lift our hearts in praise. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. We shall leave this place. Y'all, we are going to be leaving this place. We're going to be going up to heaven in the rapture with all the babies and the children going with us. This is, I'm super excited. Okay, so I wanted to show you, I mean, I'm just running on, as I usually do. I'm just running on. I can't wait to be with all of y'all. I wanted to show you a few more things. Okay, so Karen in Israel, let's see. She, that's not the one I wanted to go to. Let's see. I'm sorry. I've got so many screens up here. I don't even know where I'm going. Okay. I wanted to talk about this crazy thing that happened. 28:34. So the video that I did with the teddy bear in it, it was 28 minutes, 34 seconds. And what happened was that video, which was called, let's see. Oh my goodness, y'all, just bear with me. I'm a grandmother now. I'm a Tima. That's what I'm gonna go by, Tima. Okay, so in my thing, this video here, it says, rejoice, the day of his appearing will come at last. It says it's 28:35 there, but when I click on it, it's
Israel, so we're supposed to pray to
it's 28:34, and you see there, rejoice, the day of his appearing will come at last. Rapture ready, don't be left behind. 626 and 9/11. 626 would be in Strong's. 9/11 is just like, you know, emergency. Well, I'm just going to keep on going. I was going to try to do just a short one, but I can't do a short one. So it turned out that since my son's birthday was coming up on the 28th, I thought, I'm going to read Acts chapter 28. And so I read Acts chapter 28. I think I did that on the 16th. And it says 3 days and then 3 days and then there's another 3 days. There's 3 days. There are 3 days, 3 days, and 3 days in Acts chapter 28. So I thought that's kind of funny because the first 3 days would end up being on August 19th, which is my son's birthday and now my grandson's birthday. And then another 3 days would be August 22nd, which I love August 22nd. And then 22nd, I try not to look too far ahead. 22nd, 23rd, 24th, 25th. Well, August 25th. Well, and of course, tomorrow is the anniversary of this great American solar eclipse. And then August 25th is the day before Karen's mother's birthday in Israel. And then August 28th is the second birthday of the red heifer. And the amazing thing is that is the day that Karen got born again. The same day, August 28th of 2018. And then she got I baptized her on September 1st. So it's like every day there is a high watch connection for her and for me as to us leaving in August, which I would really love. And Sabine Blaming, I guess, I'm not sure, Blaming. I'll put a link into her videos, but she's keeping me excited because she continues to look for the fullness of Pentecost fully come. So anyway, I was like, what happened was what happened was the day that I thought, oh, you know, Austin, it was the 16th, 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th. Yeah. Okay. It's the 16th. I opened up a bill for my tooth removal, which was done on 7/17. And when I go anywhere, right, I'm going to witness. And it turned out Jill there, she was a believer. And so she was my dental assistant. So we spent a lot of time talking about the rapture coming. And, you know, for me to get her up on board as to what was going on in these times, even though, you know, she knew the times are crazy. And she's a born-again believer. So I got a bill when I wasn't expecting a bill. And the crazy thing was the bill was this same amount, $28.34. So I was like, God, I don't really understand this. So I'm going to try to find all the verses that are chapter 28, verse 34. I did look it up in Strong's, but I don't remember exactly what that had to, I don't remember what it had. And I was like, all day, I was like, God, what is this? You know, I don't really understand. Why would I get a bill for the same amount as is it just a promise that you are, the day of appearing will come at last? You know, is that just a promise that you were pleased with this video that I did? I hope, you know, I'm always trying to please the Father. I hope that the video I did pleased the Father, even if nobody watches it. I hope that, you know, it was my offering to the Lord through the video. And so the crazy thing was I finally, like that night, I thought, you know what? I've not done gematria in a couple of years because I had a watchwoman friend that I was talking with on the phone who kept telling me, oh, you know, you're so crazy about numbers and everything. You really should be doing gematria. And I was like, yeah, I don't really feel like doing gematria. I'm perfectly happy with doing Strong's. I've been doing Strong's for, I guess at that time it was about 5 years. I think now it's been 6 years I've been doing Strong's. And if you look up a number in Strong's, and I recommend looking up numbers in Strong's, don't just look at the meaning of the number. You have to go and do your Bible study and read the verses that go along with it in context to actually do a Bible study using the Strong's numbers. Because, like, for instance, I remember, you know, the Lord had told me on January 1st of 2019, when I was hoping we were going to be gone in 2018, he told me, disappointment is not the same as discouragement. And when you go and you look up the Strong's for discouraged, you're like, I don't even remember what the number was, but I was like, oh, that number means discouraged. But I had the promise of the Lord is disappointment is not the same as discouragement. And then it also, when you read the verses, it's like, be not discouraged. You have to read it in context. So people who are just doing Strong's and looking at the meaning, they're kind of like still in the milk when we're supposed to be in the meat. And God does use numbers to speak to us, but he wants us to get into the meat and dig deep into the scriptures. So it turned out that this watchwoman that I was talking to on the phone and a bunch of other watchwomen, they ended up, I mean, she was calling me like in the middle of the night asking me to do, I don't know what the deal was. I don't know. And I hope that it was just a bad situation. But she was calling me in the middle of the night under spiritual attack. And then she asked me to do gematria for, I forget what the term was, which I did. And then I called her back. And then, and she's a woman that had divorced her husband, you know. So I was like, I'm trying to help her out and everything. And then it turned out that she and these other watchwomen all labeled me a witch. And it turned out that they were saying, because I was doing this number stuff, that I was a witch. I've lost a lot of friends just over doing strongs. So I was like, God, you know, I don't really understand what this 2834 is. I don't know if it's wrong for me to do gematria. I've not done it since that instance where I got labeled a witch. And, you know, that hurt. That hurt to be, I mean, seriously, they shunned me. I would go onto a live stream and they would say, the devil has come into the live stream. A witch has come into the live stream. It was like, wow, God, I can't believe this. You know, I'm considered the enemy now. But anyway, I finally said, okay, Lord, is it okay for me to do gematria? And he said, yes. So I went to go look up the number 2834. And I was really quite amazed because... Shall I tell you what I think of you? Well, I tell the Lord all the time what I think of him, right? I wake up in the morning talking to him about how wonderful he is. And, you know, thank you for giving me the gift of eyes to see and ears to hear, and that I do know your voice and that I do have understanding. Y'all, there are people that don't understand the scriptures. There is someone who is doing gematria, who is doing strongs, looking at the stars. You know, God bless her, but she's only 6 months into this, and she's not. I was trying to encourage her in her watching for Jesus, and it ended up she told me that I preach a different gospel, that I'm a Pharisee and a legalist, and I'm just like, where is this coming from? Where is this coming from? And then I tried to continue to be a peacemaker because we're supposed to be peacemakers, Matthew chapter 5, and we're blessed for being righteous and holy and peacemakers and merciful, you know, the Beatitudes. Well, so I said something about how our promise is in Revelation 3:10 that we are going to be raptured. And she actually said that the book of Revelation is not for us. This is a person who's only been looking for the rapture for 6 months. And she said, the book of Revelation is not for us, when the book of Revelation is exactly for us. And people are getting saved off of reading the book of Revelation. And my Left Behind letters tell people to read the book of Revelation. I have Bibles at the front door, you know, by the case and on things that look like an ear. You know, an ear Bluetooth thing and wind up and all that. I mean, I made preparations for the Left Behind. And she actually said that John was the apostle for the tribulation saints and that Apostle Paul is our apostle. Well, that means then that you can't read the book of the book of John or the epistles of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And those are, 1st John is extremely huge, extremely huge. And so the reason why she's calling me a Pharisee and a legalist is because I believe that you can have victory over sin and stop sinning. Jesus said to stop sinning or something worse would happen to you. We are supposed to be holy and blameless as the pure and spotless bride. 1st John 3 says, do we keep on, those who keep on sinning, we're talking about deliberate sinning, right? Those who keep on deliberately sinning belong to the devil and not to God. We are Christ's representatives. We don't keep on sinning because then, you know, you can grieve the Holy Spirit to where he leaves you. In Psalm 51, which is the repentance psalm, David said, please, God, I have sinned with adultery. Please do not take the Holy Spirit away. And he sinned with adultery one time. That's why this is a big deal about continually sinning in adultery. It's one of those sins that's, you know, the Ten Commandments, one of those sins. And then Jesus said, if you even look with lust, you're committing adultery. And that's the reason why I'm always harping on it, because in 1 Thessalonians 4, which has the wonderful, wonderful rapture verses, at the beginning of the chapter, it says we can't be violating our marriage covenant, basically. It says it. It says that you can't be doing it, or you're not going to be making it in the rapture. that doesn't make me a Pharisee or a legalist. That makes me someone who actually believes what the Word of God says, that it's inerrant and every single word is for us, for admonishing, correcting, disciplining us. And 1 Thessalonians 4 says that we cannot be in sexual sin. So that, you know, I don't make the rules. God makes the rules. So, and actually someone's loving you when they're telling you the truth of the Bible. But there are a lot of people that there are just a lot of people that think they know the Bible, think they know the Lord. And, you know, Jesus said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? So back to this number, it turns, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that if anybody wants to learn, but it's so funny because it says, go back to sleep and dream of flying like Neo in the movie, The Matrix. Well, I fell asleep in the movie, The Matrix. My husband wanted to go and I fell asleep, but I like going back to sleep and dreaming of flying like in The Rapture. But this one just absolutely blew me away. And, I'm not allowed to mention my son's name. But couldn't you believe there's a city in Texas with this same name? And I don't think he's listening to my things, but I can't believe if he is, I love you, Austin. And Austin, it actually came up. I told him this. He just doesn't understand. Crazy mother, crazy Christian mother. But what would be the odds that I knew that I was having a boy for the longest time? Because I had an amniocentesis done. And then when he was born, I still had it down to two names. And I wasn't sure. And I had a C-section because he turned breech. So I had a C-section on the morning of the 9th. And at the 19th, August 19th. And here it says, and I ended up naming him as I was leaving the hospital. It was 5 days later that I named him. And, it says, Austin, what if God named you using gematria? I mean, I'm going to give God the glory, right? I mean, anytime you have a baby and the baby comes out healthy and here I am, I'm a mother of a 28-year-old son, I'm allowed to gush over this, but to think that God made that baby, I wasn't trying to get pregnant when I got pregnant with him. And then to think here I am on, you know, the night before his birthday, I'm looking and I find this out. Austin, what if God named you doing gematria? I mean, God makes me laugh. I think it's pretty funny. Okay, so then it says, I'm speaking the truth if you must know. You know, I believe that I am speaking the truth. You know, God says all liars go to the lake of fire. False teachers, false prophets, I don't want to be one of them. And when I'm on here and I'm trying to use my spiritual gift of teaching, whether anybody listens or not, I hope I'm speaking the truth. And here he says, I'm speaking the truth if you must know. We have been bought with the price, the blood of Jesus Christ. I know when I got born again, I know I have believeth, and he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. That's that wonderful song. And we know that we're supposed to speak the truth in love. And we know that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except through Jesus Christ. So then I'm coming down here and I'm like, oh, Revelation 9:12. That's kind of funny. And then Revelation 12:9, and then look down here. Eternal life, eternal paradise, eternal inheritance, and eternal fire, eternal damnation, eternal death in the Bible. I mean, come on. You know, I don't know if I'm ever going to do gematria again, but he told me to do it this time. And he is our eternal life. He has promised us eternal paradise. We have an eternal inheritance. And there is eternal fire and eternal damnation and eternal death for those who have not believed. Which goes with Revelation 21:8, which I use frequently in my evangelism. So Revelation 21:8 has unbelievers as only one of the categories of people that go to the lake of fire. if you believe in your head that about Jesus, if you believe in your head about Jesus, but you continue to live a life of lying, cowardice, that you're not going to stand up for Jesus, you're going to, I mean, there are times when you got to be wise about not, you know, Jesus walked away from trouble. We're supposed to not be trying to get people to kill us, for instance. But cowards, idolaters, the sexually immoral, those who do witchcraft, sorcerers, there are 8 categories, and liars. Oh my goodness, can't remember what the other 2 are. But idolatry is anything that you love, anything or anyone that you love more than Jesus. Are you thinking about Jesus? Like, do you wake up thinking about Jesus, go to bed thinking about Jesus? Do you think about Jesus as you're having to do the things that you have to do, whether it's going to school or working? You know, I'm just very blessed that I don't work. I actually got, the only time I did work after my children was born, I worked at a Christian company for 1.5 years. And I was serving those people, but it turned out I got fired for my faith. And they said, I went into the, they had a Monday morning prayer meeting because it was a Christian company. And normally I did not pray with them. I just sort of listened to them. But this time I prayed for thanking God for freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and for my job. And they called me in and fired me. So read Revelation 21:8. Examine your life. Jesus says, you know, we're supposed to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We're supposed to examine ourselves to see if we're really in the faith. And we know that in the parable of the 10 virgins, there are all 10 are looking for the bridegroom. Jesus is our bridegroom. All 10 are looking for the bridegroom. So it's important to know that heaven is real and hell is real. And who goes to hell? You find that out because Jesus warned about hell way more than he talked about heaven. Okay, so eternal life, eternal paradise, eternal inheritance, and eternal fire, eternal damnation, eternal death in the Bible is 28:34. And then we go on down. And this one, let's see. Hang on. Oh, then my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Is that not amazing? My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. You know, the gift, there is a spiritual gift of knowledge, but all of us should be seeking to know him better every day. That is what walking with Jesus, just like in the song. In the song, it said, the one to profit when you say, I am going to walk with Jesus all the way. That it, we're in a walk with Jesus. It's not just, you know, it's our hearts have been, our hearts praise him. Without a doubt, we'll know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. The rapture is for those who have been walking with Jesus. Not just believing in Jesus, but walking with Jesus. And, you know, there are a whole lot of people that are destroyed for lack of knowledge. They think, you know, they go to church. They think that that's all there is to being a Christian when it's not. We're supposed to be dying to self. We're supposed to be willing to take up our cross and follow him. We're supposed to be praying for the lost, witnessing. You know, like, it's just not that hard to do a little bit of witnessing if you have a gospel tract. It's really not hard. Then let's see, you know, a lot of this, I don't like a lot of this gematria stuff really, but then know when to leave. And here the song was, when we shall leave this place, know when to leave, you know, our, that's what we're searching for. We're still searching for, when are we leaving, Lord? Come, Lord Jesus. And then, and he put them all together into ward 3 days. When I had read Acts 28, it had 3 days in there 3 times. I'm not saying that the rapture's happening in 3 days from, obviously it didn't happen in 3 days from the day I read Acts 28. I don't know if it's happening in 3 days on August 22nd or 3 days more on August 25th. I don't know. I just want to keep looking every single day. But then the one that absolutely blew me away. I just like, can you believe that? Look at that, folks. My Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. 28:34. My Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. 28:34. Can you claim and proclaim my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Do you acknowledge him in all your ways? Do you trust in him with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding? I can't believe this. This is just amazing. And this all comes from this video here that was 28:34 seconds long. Oh, but I've got to keep on going because it turns out then yesterday I was just like, I've got it. I knew my daughter was in labor. I was just like, I got to get out of here. So I went to the pool store and it ended up, there were no other customers there. And so the guy, I can't remember his name. We talked for, 45 minutes. He was listening to my testimony of, how God first started speaking to me about my husband, divorcing me, what had gone on at that church with, all these people knowing about what was going on in the church, and a lot of other people also doing the same things with having affairs within the church. And then as I'm like, wow, thank you, God, because it really lifted up my spirit to talk to another believer who's a little bit older than I am, and just like, God, thank you. I got out of the house. I got to talk to another believer. Wasn't somebody I needed to share the gospel with. He just was a really good listener. And he's like, you have been through so many trials and tribulations. Your reward is going to be great in heaven. And I was like, wow, what a sweet thing to say. Really sweet thing to say. And so, it just encourages. It was fellowship. That's what it was. It was fellowship. So I was driving home like, praise the Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you for doing that. And then I was like, I'm going to go over to, Moe's to get, I always get a home wrecker when I go to Moe's, which is a thing because obviously my marriage, Satan destroyed my marriage. My battle is not against flesh and blood, folks. My battle is not against flesh and blood. My battle is in the spiritual realms, right? And the devil, the devil prowls around as a roaring lion looking for who he can destroy. And he was prowling around and destroying the people in that church, that false teaching, dead, spiritually dead church, which I was one of. We were all false conversions. We were all false conversions. Well, not, I mean, as far as I know, I don't really, I think maybe one person that I know that was actually spiritually alive. She told me when it came out, like 6 months afterwards, that my husband had an affair. She came up to me and she said, Terry, do not let the devil win. So that was my thing, is like, I don't want to let the devil win. And when we are not spiritually made alive, we don't realize that the devil is trying to prowl and steal, kill and destroy. So I didn't know that I needed to be, I thought I was this great Christian. I thought my husband was a great Christian. I thought I was in a great Christian church. And I didn't know that I needed to be praying, against the enemy. So anyway, I always get a home wrecker because the devil wrecked my home through this affair that this Jezebel had with my husband, okay? And, I pray that she would come to repentance. She's not the one that he's married to now, but I pray that all the Jezebels would come to repentance in Revelation 2. It says Jezebel is given a limited time to repent. She's given a time to repent before the rapture. And today, if you are a Jezebel, if you're having an affair with someone, if you are in an emotional adultery with someone, if you are in any kind of adultery, whatever, what it is. You're not walking holy and pure. You can repent today. and make it in the rapture. And I hope you do. I don't know if anybody's listening to me. Anyway, I go to Moe's to get the home wrecker. And I pull in, and the time on my phone is 5:22. I see numbers. 5:22 is Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit. Read all of Galatians chapter 5. It's how we walk by the Spirit always. It's how we walk with the Spirit of Holy Spirit, holy, instead of walking by our sinful nature, which is 19:21. And the funny thing was, my car clock is not at the right time, and my car clock is 3:17. And I started this YouTube channel on March 17th of 2017, which was the day after my first rapture dream, which was 3:16, like John 3:16 of 2017. Then the next day, he was talking to me. He told me to look up and find other people that had the same dream that I had had about being in the wedding dress and that Jesus was coming to get us. And on the 17th, when I started the channel, he told me what to name it. And, you know, the name is offensive to people. It's the goal, but it's offensive to those who want to be lukewarm in their faith. And he had me use Colossians 3:17 as the channel verse, which is, whatever you say or do, do as a representative of Christ. That's why we walk by the Holy Spirit. But then, y'all, it turns out that I looked at the car tag next to where I had parked in front of the home wrecker, and the car tag was CLM 2834. No joke, it was at 5:22 and at 3:17, CLM 2834. And if anybody's been watching me for any length of time, y'all know that I see car tags. I see them when I'm supposed to see them, but this one just blew me away, because this would have been the third time I'd seen 2834, and there it was. And so I took pictures of it, and I walked inside, and I saw the man there, and I told him, you know, he looked at me like I had a hole in my head, but there I had my Jesus mask on, and I told him, your car tag, I took a picture of it, because his daughter was still in the car. I took a picture of your car tag, in case your daughter is wondering what is this woman doing, because it means my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he looked at me like, okay. But you know what? I acknowledged him in all my ways, and there it was. And so I hope that you can acknowledge him and say, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and thank him for what he has done for you. Okay, this is something else I want to talk about. Antinomianism. Because I think this video is going to be titled, but this is a big problem. A lot of pastors don't understand this. A lot of people on YouTube do not understand this. But antinomianism is, I'm going to read this just straight up. I'll read it. Okay. The word antinomianism, like, this is a way I can teach. I've talked to pastors about this. They don't understand this word. But when you're a person who's always being labeled a legalist, this is very important. And so I thank the Lord the day that he showed me about this problem. The word antinomianism comes from two Greek words, anti, meaning against, and nomos, meaning law. Antinomianism means against the law. Theologically, antinomianism is the belief that there are no moral laws God expects Christians to obey. You know, this is using the grace of God as a license to sin, which is talked about in Jude. Antinomianism takes biblical teaching to an unbiblical conclusion. The biblical teaching is that Christians are not required to observe the Old Testament law as a means of salvation. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, he fulfilled the Old Testament law. Romans 10:4, Galatians 3:23-25. I see 3:23s all the time also. That's kind of funny. I guess I need to read that, Lord. Ephesians 2:15. The unbiblical conclusion is that there is no moral law God expects Christians to obey. The Apostle Paul dealt with the issue of antinomianism in Romans 6, 1 through 2. Now, that's the funny thing is, a red flag is when you see all these people saying gospel of grace. There is no term gospel of grace. There is gospel of the grace of God. There is one verse as far as I can tell. When I ask them, can you show me the verse with gospel of grace, they never respond to my comments. I don't know. But they love to talk about the gospel of grace. But it's the gospel of grace, the gospel of the grace of God. The grace of God, the gospel is the good news. And this is about Paul. Paul talks about this, that we need to stop sinning. But the same people who say, oh, Paul is all about grace, grace. So Apostle Paul dealt with the issue of antinomianism in Romans 6, 1 through 2. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? The most frequent attack on the doctrine of salvation by grace alone is that encourages sin. People may wonder, if I'm saved by grace and all my sins are forgiven, why not sin all I want? That thinking is not the result of a true conversion, because true conversion yields a greater desire to obey, not a lesser one. God's desire and our desire when we are regenerated by His Spirit is that we strive not to sin. Out of gratitude for His grace and forgiveness, we want to please Him. God has given us His infinitely gracious gift of salvation through Jesus, John 3:16, like my first rapture dream on 3:16, Romans 5:8. Our response is to consecrate our lives to Him. Consecrate, make holy, out of love, worship, and gratitude for what He has done for us. Romans 12:1 through 2. Those are the sanctification verses, Romans 12:1-2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And let's see, by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. All these people, oh, you know, we don't have to be perfect. It's okay. Well, no, that's the verse. You're supposed to discern daily what is the will of God for my life, what is good and acceptable and perfect to please the Lord. Okay, back to the thing. Antinomianism is unbiblical in that it misapplies the meaning of God's gracious favor. The second reason that antinomianism is unbiblical is that there is a moral law God expects us to obey. 1 John 5:3 tells us, this is love for God, to obey His commands, and His commands are not burdensome. What is this law God expects us to obey? It is the law of Christ, not the law of Moses, the law of Christ, which is love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the love and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Well, there's another 22. A wonderful, wonderful 22, Matthew 22, 37 through 40. I told you God loves the number 22. No, we are not under the Old Testament law. Yes, we are under the law of Christ. The law of Christ is not an extensive list of legal codes. It is a law of love. If we love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we will do nothing to displease Him. If we love our neighbors as ourselves, we will do nothing to harm them. Think about that. That includes our spouses. If we love God and love our neighbors and love our spouses, we won't do anything to harm them. It keeps us on the narrow road. Obeying the law of Christ is not a requirement to earn or maintain salvation. The law of Christ is what God expects of a Christian. Antinomianism is contrary to everything the Bible teaches. God expects us to live a life of morality, integrity, and love. Jesus Christ freed us from the burdensome commands of the Old Testament law, but that is not a license to sin. Rather, it is a covenant of grace. We are to strive to overcome sin and cultivate righteousness, depending on the Holy Spirit to help us. Thank you, Jesus. I say thank you, Jesus, because Jesus died on the cross, was buried, rose on the third day, and when he rose and ascended to heaven, then he gave us his Holy Spirit at Pentecost. And for now, every born-again believer has received the Holy Spirit that gives us the power to overcome sin and cultivate righteousness. The fact that we are graciously freed from the demands of the Old Testament law should result in our living our lives in obedience to the law of Christ. 1 John 2, 3-6 declares, "We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. The man who says, 'I know him,' but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know that we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did." I hope that edifies and encourages someone, and also teaches, because I want to teach the truth in love. This is from gotquestions.org. I can't say that I agree with everything that Got Questions does, because they're really good, but they are wrong on divorce and remarriage, adultery. And I also will put in a link to Karen's video about divorce and remarriage, because the Lord had her do a video specifically about that, because she has friends who are their parents are divorced and remarried, and it's a very complicated issue, and I'm like one of the few channels that talks about this. Please also check out my playlist, because my playlist for divorce and remarriage adultery, let's see how many. I know I added some recently. I added some to Who is the Antichrist. He spoke on TV last night, you know, in the Democratic National Convention. I had a hard time watching it, but I did watch it. And, you know, he was not overly, he didn't actually have a lot of coded words as far as his hatred for Christians or anything like that. And at the very end, he just said, "God bless." He didn't say "God bless America" like normal pastors, normal presidents would do. Let's see, playlist. If anybody is still with me, let's just see. I've got 8 videos about how to walk in the Holy Spirit. Rapture dreams, persistent prayer, American Christianity in trouble. You know, I'm just sharing. You know, judgment for the sexually immoral. How many channels have a playlist like that with 12 videos? But, you know, abstain from sexual immorality is one of the 4 commandments that the brand new disciples of Jesus were given. I think it's Acts chapter 15. Be holy like Jesus. 11 videos there. Testimonies of being born again. False churches will lead you astray to hell. There's the one about the songs that God has had me write. False hyper grace doctrine. Fake Christians everywhere. The false 3 days of darkness. Permanence of marriage until death. God the creator through Jesus his son. False flat earth cult. Heaven, near-death experience. I only got one there. Eternal hell, God warned. I don't know how many channels are talking about hell, but Jesus talked about hell, so I'm going to talk about hell. 42 videos on that one. Pre-tribulation rapture for true Christians. 132 videos. Y'all, we have to fight that the rapture is for, is a pre-tribulation rapture for true Christians. I went on to look at some websites thinking that they were good, and if you just go, they're like, you know, if you just go, they actually will say, oh, we don't believe in the pre-tribulation rapture. Well, I don't need to waste my time on that website. Even though this was a website that was about end times. False doctrine of once saved, always saved. David Pawson, great book, great book. Avoid Jezebel and obey Christ. Jesus Christ is Lord. Marriage is restored after divorce. 19 things, 19 videos. These are incredible testimonies of the power of prayer when you are praying in the spiritual realm instead of having unforgiveness and anger in your heart towards the person that's divorced you. I'm praying for Gigi Baker. I've been praying for her for a very long time that God will restore her marriage if we're still here. Testimonies of adultery, deliverance, and remarriage. 16 of those. Ex-Muslims meet Jesus. Look at that. 236 videos about divorce and remarriage adultery. And I added a few more recently. I think I was at 225. I added a few more. It just sort of like goes. This is the biggest problem in America. And, you know, it's actually a big problem in a lot of other countries because America kind of just started it. Hearing God, 37 videos. True Christianity, born again, 86 videos. Then we get to pump up music, which I know, you know, there's some people in there that are, their songs are good, but they're not really walking with God. The gospel, forgiveness and redemption, 39 videos. And then going home songs, 61. And whoever misses the rapture, 107. Okay. I just hope y'all are all doing really well. I hope there's something here on my channel that you could just find and just watch to, you know, we're supposed to be on meat. I've had 15 years of studying the Bible every day, and I've just been blessed. I've been blessed and been in a lot of, it's kind of funny when people tell me that the book of Revelation is not for us when I've done I've done 7 Bible studies on the book of Revelation. And, something else I wanted to show y'all. Let's see. Here we go. And in fact, if we're still here and you want me to order and mail you this book, I am willing to do that. I will pay for it and I will mail it to you. It's a book called The Nonprofit's Guide to Revelation. And it's very good. I think it's been out about, I think he put it out last fall, and he's a fairly new at rapture awareness, but I've done 7, like when I say I've done 7 Bible studies, this is like with groups of, I did women's Bible studies. So I've done 7 Bible studies, like one of the Bible studies lasted for 7 months. I had a daughter that did a Revelation Bible study with Preset Ministries that it was for 15 months, over a year, line by line of Revelation that then you know, you're going back with how this all fits in with the rest of the Bible. This says, is Revelation practical? This is a relevant question. With all the struggles people go through in life and with all the significant physical needs and global crises present in our world today, why should we take the time to read Revelation with all its symbolism, mysteries, apocalyptic language, and scary scenarios? Because it is the capstone of Scripture, the climax of the story, the resolution of a biblical narrative. Ignoring Revelation would be like going to a movie and walking out before the best part. In practical terms, understanding Revelation gives us deeper confidence in Scripture, anchors our focus on the promised future and eternal hope, purifies our Christian life, pushes us to share our faith. That's the problem. People who don't read Revelation, they're not out witnessing because they're not on fire for Jesus. And when you read Revelation and you love your neighbor as yourself, you want them to get saved. You want them to get saved. You don't want them to have to be left behind. And it helps us make sense of the way the world is today. And boy, can we see it. As we embark on this incredibly practical overview of the most amazing yet most avoided book of the Bible, keep your knowledge of the Old Testament running in the background. I'll include relevant cross-references when needed to help clarify various passages of Revelation. You're in for a treat as we jump into Revelation 1, where you will see a new and radical picture of the risen and reigning Jesus Christ. And so there are various names used for the tribulation period: Jacob's trouble, Daniel's 70th week, a time of distress, the great day, the hour of testing, the indignation, tribulation, great tribulation, and the day of the Lord. If you hung with me to listen to me for this long on this video, which is pretty rare that anybody would do that, but if you have, and you want me to order this, you know, if you want to order this, have me order this and mail it to you, I would be happy to do that. I would be happy to do it. It's a great book, and I do recommend it. Or you can watch the videos about the pre-tribulation rapture. I have a lot of really good ones. So anyway, I love everybody, and I'm hoping that we're leaving any day now, maybe even by August 22nd, which would be just thrilling. All right. Love you. Bye-bye.